Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Grounded by Aisha Saeed, Huda Al-Marashi, Jamilah Thompkins-Bigelow, and S.K. Ali. Narrated by Amir Abdullah, Deepa Samuel, Neil Shah, and Jeed Saddy. Chapter 1. Feek. I'm getting too old for this stuff. I mean, I'm 12. That's dumb close to teenager. Definitely too old to be spending all my time with a four-year-old. A four-year-old sister named Ruki who talks too much and talks too loud, especially when I'm trying to hear the rhymes in my head. Her voice jumps in front of the lyrics every time. Here in Hurston Airport's indoor playground, I'm watching Ruki again because my new baby brother, Hamza, started crying again. Mom scooped him up and said she would be right back, but I know that isn't happening. I look at my phone, 7:33 p.m. It's been 10 minutes. Still no mom. Ruki has lots to play with here. A fake helicopter with a slide, a command center jungle gym, and the engine of a real airplane. Even I would check out that engine, if I was still a kid. But Rookie's not playing. She's skipping over to talk to me while I'm watching Storm the Stage, a poetry slam show, on my phone. It's hosted by Doc Hoffa, a rapper from way back who my parents love. My family even got to visit his extra lavish mansion with marble and gold floors once. And that's one funny story.
You're not listening. Let's go on an adventure.
Ruki pulls my arm. I shake her off and say, the helicopter's an adventure. Look inside. See how far you can fly away. Thankfully, she hops over to it. I'm chuckling, watching one poet describe himself as chocolate mousse, then cookie dough ice cream, when it happens. A rhyme drops into my mind. I know from my dad, who performs poetry for a living, that when rhymes drop, you stop and catch them. Because it doesn't just happen every day. Definitely not when I'm watching this show. On this show, these poets make me shut up and listen, make me suck in my breath, make me rip out pages from my rhyme book to start all over again, to try to be just as good. But then I freeze. Can I write something that cool? That question sucker punches my it. Not this time. I'm thinking about the slick ways this poet is comparing himself to desserts. So smooth. But I would never describe myself that way, I think. Nah, I'm not sweets. I'm... And it drops. I'm the words to the song, the hammer to the gong, the beats to this rhythm, the...
Feek!
Ruki screams. What? I'm writing. Go play. But as I try to get a hold of the rest of the words, she keeps yapping.
Let's go to the shiny house. I want to see it.
She's been calling the gigantic glass box thing near our gate the shiny house since we first passed it. Focus, focus. What comes next? What rhymes with rhythm? But the words are gone. And when I finally look up from my notebook, so is Ruki. But I didn't lose Ruki. It's not like that. I bet she's at that glass thing she was talking about. I just got to be cool, retrace our steps, head back toward the gate. I see that glass box with the silver tracks and metal balls inside that gleam even from a distance and almost run. Almost. I catch myself and remember the brand new sneaks I'm wearing, white Air Force Ones that I finally convinced Mom to buy me. I'm not getting creases in them for nobody. Definitely not Ruki. I speedwalk without bending my feet. It's kind of a waddle, but I do it smooth. She's got to be there. It's surrounded by kids wearing kufis and kimars, which makes me smile as I pass my hand over my own kufi. There's hundreds of Muslims in this airport. Like us, everyone's leaving Mona, the Muslims of North America Conference. Inside that big glass box is a contraption of balls ping-ponging and spiraling around tracks and gears in chain reaction after chain reaction. It's kind of cool how they keep following the same maze-like path. I read the placard on the front. Rube Goldberg Machine. I almost reach out to pull the golden lever that activates the machine. I put my hands in my front hoodie pocket instead. A little boy pulls it, and five hanging steel balls start swinging back and forth. One ball hits the others, clack, and the others hit back, clack, 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 clack. Every ball has an impact. With all that going on, I see why little kids like Ruki are into this thing. But as I search the hijabbed heads around the machine, I don't see Ruki's silver scarf with the sparkly unicorn headband she wears everywhere. I don't see Ruki's face. My chest tightens. Is Ruki okay? Of course she's okay. Breathe. Think. Think. Where would she go? I feel a buzz in my pocket and check my texts. Mom. Salam. Sorry I'm taking so long. Hamza got poop everywhere. You two all right? Where would Ruki go? Me. Yeah, we're cool. I'm taking Ruki to look at iPads. Mom. Great. Meet me back at the gate when you're done. Don't panic. Mom. And sorry I exploded last night. Thanks for helping me so much with your sister. I hear and feel a whimper come out of me when I think about last night. If Mom finds out I lost track of Ruki again, I'll get a whole lot worse than yelling. I shove my phone in my pocket. No way am I getting grounded. I didn't really lose her then, and she's not lost now. Not really. She's looking at iPads. She loves those. I flat-foot shuffle toward shops with flashy electronics that would grab a four-year-old. I stare hard into one store. Please let Ruki be here. I can see from the startled eyes of a red-headed cashier with a tatted-up arm that I kind of spook her. I cock my head and give her my calmest, coolest smile. She smiles back. Look calm, I tell myself as I walk on. Looking calm makes things work out, like last night. At the fancy, boring conference banquet, listening to fancy, boring people speak, me and Mom and Hamza and Ruki, we're sitting at a table with shiny dishes and too many forks and spoons for each person. As usual, Dad wasn't there. Dad is Abdusalam Styles, or Salam Styles, as everyone calls him, the Muslim lyricist. He had been performing nonstop at the conference and was sleeping in the hotel until his next performance later that night. Hamza started crying at the table. Mom left with him. It was just me and Ruki again, but at least she was being quiet. While the fancy, boring speech droned on, rhymes filled my ears. I pushed aside my plate and plopped my notebook onto the table. I went in. I wanted Dad to see these new poems, to see how good I was getting. Almost as good as him. We could be a father and son team. I pictured him asking me to tour with him as Feek Styles, the Muslim MC. That made me laugh. And then, I was no longer hearing the fancy, boring speech. Instead, I heard Ruki's voice, on full blast. I looked to the stage and blinked a few times at the light dancing off her headband. This had to be a bad dream. The keynote speaker was staring at Ruki like they were sharing an inside joke, while Ruki was holding the mic, telling the whole banquet why it was important to take turns letting people talk. I waddle ran up there and snatched the mic. Look calm, I told myself before telling the audience something I don't even remember that made them laugh, then yanking Ruki off the stage. Mom yelled at me about it, said people came before poetry, family before art. But Dad's not here with us at the airport. So much for family before art. I'm not mad about it. He has more important places to be than waiting around with us here. I walk down the corridor. Look calm, look calm, look calm. Flat footstep, a little smile. Ruki isn't lost. She is fine. She has to be. I push away thoughts of anything bad happening to her and shuffle on until I almost trip on something shiny. I look down and yelp. Ruki's unicorn headband.
Chapter 2. Hanna. People come to airports to catch flights, to go places. But I'm here for another reason, too. I'm here for my number one mission in life. That's why I'm making my way back to TSA right now, far away from where Dad's waiting for our flight at gate B10. He doesn't know what I'm up to. He thinks we're just here to get on a plane to visit his cousin in New York before we fly home to Doha after the Mona conference. But, of course, there are more important things in life, like life itself. I notice an electronics store up ahead and slow down. Should I? Check how much Dad paid for the phone he bought me before the conference? I just need to know if it's a bribe gift, because as I step inside the store, the phone in question reminds me not to get sidetracked from my mission by pinging a Google News alert for the keywords, Hurston Airport Cat Missing. Family of cat missing at Hurston Airport. It's been a week, and we're heartbroken. I click and read the article, but there's no fresh information on Snickerdoodle the cat, who is lost at this very airport I'm standing in right now. A cat, scared for her life, all alone, with no one to look out for her. But not for long, because I'm going to find her. As usual, I had been excited to come to the annual Mona conference. We'd been attending every summer since I was 6, and now I have a crew of friends I meet up with each year. Friends Dad finally let me hang out with by myself for the entire weekend. Well, he did his own thing, a thing I knew about, that he didn't know I knew about. This year, the regular conference excitement had been multiplied by 1,000 when I discovered that we were flying through Zora Neale Hurston Airport. I'd be able to help find the lost Snickerdoodle. It's my specialty, helping animals. It's too bad my Mona friends are not here at the airport right now, though. They completely know me and get why I'm here on Earth, for my life purpose, and would jump in to help me without missing a heartbeat. I believe everyone has a life purpose, and that this is mine: to protect and save any and every animal in my vicinity by any and every means necessary. I also believe in Allah, and I think he put me here at this particular airport exactly a week after Snickerdoodle went missing for this reason. I had to be the one to reunite her with her heartbroken family. Heartbroken has been mentioned in almost every article on Snickerdoodle, and really, if any family hadn't been heartbroken about their cat wandering around pitifully in a huge airport, I'd probably want to give the lost animal to a better family. I found out about Snickerdoodle through the animal rights forum I belong to, Animal Allies. We are a global forum of people of all ages who care about the well-being of all beings, not just humans. That's the mission statement of AA. As soon as I read it, I clicked join. I lean against a counter in the electronics store and open my notes app to reread the facts I've stored about Snickerdoodle. Name: Snickerdoodle Mildred Hoffman. Age: 12. Hometown: Los Angeles, California. Went missing on August 27th. Where? TSA screening at Hurston Airport. Escaped when pet carrier was opened during security examination. Answers to Snicker, Doodles, and sometimes Millie. Likes: Meow Mix treats, salmon flavor. Nose strokes, shoes, lying on paper. Dislikes: wide open spaces, babies, vacuums, tall men. Where had I gathered this extra special, extra specific information from that Animal Allies didn't provide? Facebook, which I'm not even allowed to join until I'm 13, not for another year and a half. But Dad has a Facebook account, And before he banned me from it by changing his password, I used his account to message the Hoffman family on their page, "Snickerdoodle is missing. Please help," to gather vital information. Like that Snickerdoodle loves Meow Mix salmon treats, which I have a huge pack of in my backpack now, to lure her when I find her. I'd better head back to where she was last seen, the TSA security checkpoint. Dad wanted to go straight to our gate, so I wasn't able to take pictures of the scene of the crime when we passed through earlier. It's a crime to lose an animal that was entrusted to the airport. In my mind, it is, anyway. And if it isn't a crime in the airport's mind, I mean the airport staff's mind, then that is a crime too. Before leaving the electronics store, I quickly checked the iPhones on display. So Dad had spent a lot on my phone. That makes me feel a tiny pinch of guilt. I practically ignored Dad the entire weekend, answering in short one-word or few-word sentences to any question he'd asked. And then I left him at gate B10 when he asked if he could talk to me about something important. I told him I needed to get food from the food court, which wasn't true at all. I'd stuffed myself with pancakes at the all-you-can-eat, all-day breakfast restaurant before we got a cab to the airport. While Dad knew all about my interest in Snickerdoodle, he'd told me he didn't want me wandering around the airport so close to our departure time, hence the necessary secrecy. Even though Dad is pretty laid back at home with me, he's all about sticking to official rules about things in public, while I think not all rules are meant to be followed. Like, if a pet has been missing for an entire week and is dangerously close to death, it's time to break some rules. Though, I do feel a tiny bit sad remembering the way Dad's face and body slumped in the chair at the gate when I almost ran away from him. But then, I remember something else, and the sadness disappears. It's the thing I discovered when I used his Facebook account to message the heartbroken Hoffman family about Snickerdoodle. Dad had signed up for the Mona matrimonial match dinner on Friday at the conference, and the Mona matrimonial speed match event on Saturday, and also the Mona matrimonial match database. At first, I didn't know what all that meant, but then I looked up matrimonial and learned it meant he wanted to get married again. He'd been busy the entire weekend trying to get married by any and all means necessary. Talk about having a life purpose. Mine is saving animals, and Dad's is getting a replacement mom for me? Without my permission? I sigh heavily and then swallow a different sort of sadness clogging my throat before stepping out of the store. I'm snapping some pictures of an empty corridor with carpeting, maybe very cozy for cats, on my way to TSA, when I see someone else, a kid my age, looking around for something. Could it be another lost pet? I pause. He's wearing a hoodie like mine, except his is white, while mine is teal and tied around my waist. His head is turning wildly around, peering into the corridor I'd just taken a picture of, then peering into the sunglasses kiosk opposite to it. It's the kid who carried his little sister off the stage at the fancy Mona banquet dinner featuring Congresswoman Sarah Najjar. He sees me looking at him and does a fast look away, but then looks back and nods like he knows me or something. It must be the Mona Conference t-shirt I'm wearing. "Did you lose something?" I ask. "A cat? Or some other pet?" "What?" His body stills and his hands go into his hoodie pockets, like he's protecting himself or trying to look unfrantic. "Why?" "Yep, he's lost something. something important. Because I'm looking for something too, and I can help you look. I hold up my phone. I'm looking for a lost cat myself, and I'm good at taking notes.
You lost a cat here?
Not me. I swipe to find my screenshot of the Snickerdoodle is missing, please help Facebook page. This family lost Snickerdoodle.
You know them or something? The people who lost their cat?
I'm doing them a service, I say, wondering if I should say I'd been hired by the heartbroken Hoffmans because they had communicated with me via Dad's Facebook messages. I'm working for them, and I can help you too. He looks at me, like some people do when I go on about animals for too long, eyebrows scrunched, trying to figure out whether I'm too weird to talk to or some kind of cool they don't know yet. I swipe my phone again and show him my notes. I don't know if that's convincing, but he takes his hands out of his hoodie pockets and says,
"Okay, yeah. I lost my sister."
Whoa.
Chapter 3. Sami. Please download. Please download. Please download. Turns out pleading with your iPad does not, in fact, make it work faster. I bite my lip. The flight tracker app is refusing to load. Not that it's my iPad's fault. This airport is the worst. The longest security line, the most pointless food court, half the restaurants are closed, and it's not even 9 o'clock. The most uncomfortable seats, and seriously, the worst Wi-Fi in the history of humanity. I really wish I had a phone. My parents and I are situated strategically by the boarding entrance, our backs to the floor-to-ceiling windows overlooking the planes coming and going. I can't stop myself from continuously peering back at the tarmac. Our flight takes off soon, but the plane is nowhere to be found. I have a bad feeling. I murmur.
It'll be okay.
My father ruffles my hair. And my iPad barely works, I complain. There's a good app to track flights, but—
Patience, Sami. Following the plane's flight path won't make it come any sooner.
He's right. I know he's right. But I'll check the monitors, I tell my parents. Good idea. My mother nods. And I'm sure the plane will be here before you know it. I'm not so sure about that. I stick my tablet in my book bag and look at the gray clouds outside, blotting out any stars or moonlight. I carefully avoid outstretched legs and the luggage strewn in the aisles as I make my way toward the bright blue electronic board listing departure times. Stepping into the hallway, I nearly bump into a golden brown retriever.
Woof!
He's wagging his tail at me and wears a sign that reads, "Travel Buddy." "Would you like to pet him?" The woman holding the leash asks. I say. "Sometimes animals like Biscuit here visit airports. They're ready to snuggle anyone who wants to feel a little better about their flight." She smiles. "Can be a little nerve-wracking for some people sometimes." Do I look that freaked out? Did this dog beeline straight for me? I awkwardly pat the dog's head. He's cute. I have something I was on my way to do, but thanks. I jostle for a spot among the other travelers crowded around the monitor and look up at the departure times. Finally, I see it. MCO, the three-letter code for Orlando, Florida. On time. Which should make me feel better. Except I'm not so sure about that. For one thing, we're supposedly boarding in 30 minutes, and our plane isn't even here yet. For another thing, those are some super dark and low-hanging clouds gathering out the window behind where my parents are sitting. Cumulonimbus clouds are not something you want to see when you need your flight to take off as soon as possible so you can at least get some rest before your very first away karate competition. Sensei Medea's counting on me. He said so himself. I'm the one who has the roundhouse kick down best. Last week at practice, we all had to show him our best moves, and I nearly toppled him. "Way to go," he grinned once he caught his balance. He gave me a huge high five. You're going to help us bring home the championship, Sammy. My outfit is pressed and starched and hanging behind my bedroom door. I even made a list of all sorts of fun stuff we can play as a group on the bus ride up, like Mafia, Celebrity, and Heads Up. Coach Medea said we're not going to zone out on our phones for the whole drive, which works for me since I don't have a phone. And since the dojo's only 2 miles from the University of Florida, my big brother, Ibrahim, said he would come to cheer me on. But if this flight doesn't take off as planned, everything will be ruined. Ibrahim always tells me there's no point in worrying about things that are out of your control. Half the time, whatever you're freaking out about doesn't even happen. Except that means that the other half of the time, it does. And right now, I flinch as the blue on-time departure next to Orlando switches to a bright red delayed, and the time flips from 9:30 p.m. to 9:35 p.m. It's just 5 minutes, I tell myself as my pulse quickens. 300 seconds. That's all? Except, actually, no, that's not all. I know how this goes. First it's 5 minutes, then 10, then 30, then... No. I shake my head and take a step away from the monitors and try to channel my brother. 5 minutes might really just be 5 minutes. Everything could be okay. But as much as I tell myself this, my hammering heart refuses to believe me.
Rookie, where are you?
A boy shouts out. A boy and a girl, both about my age, hurry in my direction.
Stop playing,
he says.
This isn't funny.
Don't worry, Rookie's around here somewhere. The girl reassures the boy. The girl's hair is tied up in a ponytail, and she has on glasses. A colorful scarf is tied like a lasso around one of the loops of her jeans. The boy looks familiar. As I get closer, I take in his dark jeans and his shoes, the super white Nikes, and I realize I definitely did see him. He was at the conference, and his little sister jumped onto the stage during the final keynote address. She'd marched up to that microphone and spoken with so much confidence, her voice echoing through the room, that for a second I thought maybe she was the keynote speaker, even though her head didn't peek over the podium. The boy scooped her from the stage, but not before leaning in and joking about her being the warm-up act. Everyone laughed. Some people really do stay cool, calm, and collected, even when their little sister leaps onto the stage. I could never have done that. Even the little girl, who couldn't have been more than 5, was cooler than I could ever be. Although, as I see him closer up, he looks a little flustered right now. When I check the monitor again, my heart drops straight to my feet. The time has changed again. Our flight is officially 10 minutes late, and there is still no plane at the gate. I take a deep breath in and out. Again and again. It doesn't help. Relax, Ibrahim would tell me if he were here right now. Instead of fixating on what's freaking you out, do something to get your mind off things. He's right. Freaking out just makes you freak out more. It's like a spiraling stack of dominoes crashing down. I know a 10-minute delay, for now, isn't the end of the world. There are way worse things happening in the universe right this very minute. I just wish my brain could get through to my heart, which isn't listening at all. Beads of sweat pop up along my forehead. As I approach the bathroom to splash my face with water, a boy stumbles out. He's the same kid from earlier. Up close, I can see he looks scared. Maybe even more than me right now. Are you okay? I ask. He looks at me and slowly shakes his head. He begins. But before he can finish his sentence, we hear a shout. Rookie! It's the girl with the lasso scarf. She's hurrying out of the girls' bathroom next door. Looking at the boy, she shakes her head. Not in there either.
We're running out of places,
he says. There's a quiver in his voice. Don't worry, she says. We'll find her. The puzzle pieces start to come together. The girl from yesterday, she's missing. No wonder this boy looks terrified. Do you need help? I ask. Security's got a desk down the hall past my gate. The girl looks at me with surprise. She brightens a little. Uh-oh. We could use some help. She nods. I'm Hanna. This is Feek. His little sister, Ruki, wandered off. And it's kind of an all-hands-on-deck situation. Maybe you could help us cover more area?
They want my help? The kid who was on his way to douse his face in the sink to fend off a meltdown? I glance at Feek, but he's busy scanning the gate behind me. Oh, that's awful, I say. I lost track of my parents at Disney World when I was 5, and I still feel slightly traumatized. Ruki must be terrified. But why are they looking for her themselves? I have a flight, I tell her, but we should alert.
Yeah, we all have flights.
She frowns. Shouldn't we tell someone? I try again. Security? The police?
Security?
She crinkles her nose.
Security here is not exactly amazing. Trust me on that. Feek's got some good ideas of where she's dashed off. We're narrowing it down by process of elimination.
Yeah,
Feek says. She's gotta be here somewhere. My cheeks flush. I'm nervous to say no, but I'm equally nervous to say yes. When I look at Feek and Hanna discussing the next place they'll search, I can see Feek's worry waft over him like swirls of frost. They need help. I think of Ibrahim. Instead of fixating, do something. I glance at the departure monitor. Sure enough, our delay has gone from 10 minutes to 30 minutes. I join Feek and Hanna. We take off at a brisk pace down the hallway. I might not be able to control that departure board, but I can definitely do this. I can try to help them find Ruki.
Chapter 4. Nora. The chocolate garden was closed. C-L-O-S-E-D. Doors locked, lights off, closed. It's my favorite place in the world, and my mom promised to take me for my special birthday trip this weekend. She was giving the keynote address at some Islamic convention, and she said it would be fun for us to have some quality time together. So I spent days planning my trip to the chocolate garden, my outfit, and all the videos I was going to post on NokNok, because I'm a sweetie, which is kind of like a foodie, but I post about all things sweet. Me at French bakeries. Me at old-fashioned ice cream parlors. Me at fine candy stores. And the chocolate garden was going to be me in chocolate heaven. But my mom had appearances and meetings booked the entire weekend. And by the time we stopped at the chocolate garden on our way to the airport, the only thing left for me to do was look through the darkened windows. Now I'm stuck at the gate with Congress Mom, the super important Sarah Najjar. She's taking a call and I'm scrolling through NokNok and seriously wondering why she even had me. Like, should you be a parent if you can't provide for your kids' basic needs for chocolate and NokNok? Which is my job, okay? It's not all fun. It's more like homework, and parents are supposed to help you with your homework. And yes, it is a need, not just a want, like my mom was trying to convince me. She consoled me that there was another chocolate garden branch in the airport, but when we got here, it was closed too. My mom doesn't understand that the chocolate garden's dreamy milk chocolate, nougat, and pretzel bar is seriously the best thing I've ever put in my mouth, and posting about it was going to boost my follower count. My two best friends, Kennedy and Mackenzie, eked past me with their hair tutorials just last week, which really bothered me. Like there aren't already a million people doing hair on NokNok. Thinking about all the ways my hopes have been dashed this weekend frustrates me so much that I grab my stuff and move 4 seats down. As soon as I sit, I hear a notification on my phone. Mackenzie. Ah, how was it? Bet you got a ton of clips. Kennedy. What time is your birthday party when you get back? Can't wait. I stare at their messages, but I can't think of what to write back. We've been friends since the first grade, but sometimes they don't understand my life. They're always telling me how lucky I am because I go on all these trips with Congressmom, but they don't see this side. The canceled plans, the getting dragged to a Muslim conference where I felt totally out of place. That last part, I definitely don't discuss with my friends. My mom is always telling me how her grandparents came from Lebanon and how they worked hard to build a good life for their children and grandchildren. She wants me to grow up to be a strong Arab-American Muslim woman, but I don't feel Arab or Muslim. Going to Mona only made that feeling worse. We don't practice Islam like the people at Mona, praying and fasting, eating halal meat. There's only one other Muslim kid in my class, a girl named Sumeya, and things are complicated between us. I reread Kennedy and Mackenzie's messages. Do I tell them I didn't make it to the chocolate garden? How do I explain that? I slide my phone into my purse. Maybe they'll think I'm already in the air. Air is exactly what I need right now, but since I can't go outside, I'll settle for something sweet. I bet the only thing worth trying in the food court is.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.